If you're brand new to jazz and you don't know where to start, man, follow us along because we are on a journey together, he and I, and we are loving every minute of it.
Yeah, welcome back to the Unconnoisseur channel. My name is Drew.
My name is Matt.
We are your hosts for this channel and this journey. And today, this week, we get to talk about the saxophone player out of Britain. His name, Tubby Hayes. The album is Mexican Green, and it was on Fontana. It came out in 1967. Matt, as we get started, I have a question that I want to ask you about this album, and then we'll talk about our week in music.
All right.
Do you think you would have rated it much higher today than you did a year ago when we listened to it?
I was afraid of that just because of the text that I sent you yesterday. Well, let's put it this way. A year ago, we didn't know what we didn't know. And today, a year later, we still don't know a whole lot, but we know that we may have missed something on our rating for Tubby Hayes a year ago.
We are the Unconnoisseurs. We're learning as we go and grow. We're picking up the albums that we appreciate. We rate them along the way. I remember a few weeks ago that you said, you know, I'm going to change my rating, and I blew a gasket. I listened back to the episode 2 weeks before that, and I had actually done something similar. I said, I didn't write it down. I'm going to give it this. So I thought about that last night. You know, what would we talk about with our rating? Y'all have to stay tuned for what we rate this album right at the end of the episode, and be prepared for next week's album, which is pretty cool as well. I just happened to look forward to that. So we know what we're in for. So
I would say that we probably should just stick with our rating, what we rated it when we rated it. That was our first impression. That was, again, what we didn't know. So I think it's fair. Our rating system is fair.
Yep. Right? I wholeheartedly agree. I'm not changing it.
Going back a year later, and we may kick ourselves every once in a while with the ratings we give, right?
88. We'll kick ourselves there. But we were just talking before we hit record about the documentary that we both happened across last night, the Tubby Hayes documentary on Amazon. It is actually called A Man in a Hurry. And I think that what we found, what we are finding as we go, there, it's an extra week to pick up more information on who this player was. So that's been pretty cool. What was your week in music? What was your week in life? How has your life shaped your jazz music this week?
Well, you remember last week I clogged up the drain, right? And I had drain problems in my kitchen.
Blueberries, baby.
Blueberries, right? So Friday we had a small incident. I'll tell you about that later offline. But Kendra came home at 5 o'clock and we heard this clang, 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 big clang in the garage. Didn't think anything of it. You know, we both walked out. Nothing had fallen because that door slammed quite hard. And we get ourselves ready. We're going to go out for dinner with Jason and Stacy and hit the garage door button and the garage door doesn't go up.
Oh, no.
So the garage spring broke. So we were without a garage door all week.
Oh, you're kidding.
Which it was okay. I mean, you know, it's a heavy door. And as long as I can lift it up and hold it, once it gets up there, it's holdable.
Yeah.
And Kendra can back in and out. But yeah, it was just one thing after the other this week. And but the weekend music, man, I'll tell you, you know, the fun part about this journey is the album that we're working on, the rabbit holes that we go down with that particular artist, and then coming back and doing the week that we're recording, okay, because we got to listen to that music again. But then finding a way to work in what, and I hate to say it like this, but what you actually want to listen to. So for me, I found a new big band.
Let me do a notepad out. Hang on.
Yeah. Chuck Owen and the Jazz Surge. I texted you this.
Okay. Yeah.
I texted you the picture. Chuck Owen and the Jazz Surge, the album that I was really digging on, and I even listened to it a little bit this morning. Was from 1995. It's self-titled Chuck Owen and the Jazz Surge, but holy cow. Me looking forward to Wednesday this week, you know, the Three Rivers big band at the club room. So I'm going to go down and hear Three Rivers. I mean, yeah, forget about it. But, so that was my week. That was my week in music. You know, again, the artist that we're focused on, you and me on our journey now, and then the artist that we're recording this week. And then, yeah, that other big band. Whew, wow.
Yeah.
It was a lot.
So I want to ask you this, because we're covering 92 today, and you and I are covering something halfway through the magazine personally. Does it ever seem like it may be a little overwhelming to catch two albums a week, or do you find yourself with, like Tubby Hayes for this week, not really listening to this album, but looking a little bit deeper, digging down that rabbit hole a little bit further? Is that what you find?
Yes, absolutely.
And yes. And I found the same, the names of who played on it. Where did they go? What were they? And I found myself rabbit holing a little bit more, chasing bunny rabbits, if you will. Mm-hmm. But yeah, well, I'm asking just personally, if you struggle, well, like, does it ever seem overwhelming to listen to this much jazz in one week?
I go through phases. Let's put it that way. On Tuesday, when you and I talk and we move on to the next artist, I get all worked up and I want to listen to that album right away and over again. And then by Wednesday, I'm focusing on maybe another album or a different decade of that album or artist. And then Thursday, I try and stay on that artist, but I seem to veer off a little bit. Friday, I just go ape crazy. I just can't focus because I want it all so much. Yeah. You know, that's me. I did listen to a couple of other Tubby Hayes' albums though this week. The Jazz Genius, and then Grits, Beans, and Grits, Beans, and Greens.
Okay.
That's from 69. And holy cow. Dude plays like, he plays like Coltrane. I mean, lots of notes. Well, he plays like Brecker. Lots of notes, lots of things to say.
Yep.
And, you know, Mexican Green, as good as it is, doesn't showcase his style, I think, as much as the other two albums. Wow.
When you watch the documentary, I know that you didn't do it last night. When you came across it, I was up very late. So I did watch it, and then I was building bikes today, so I listened to it again. They kind of talk about that, what Mexican Green is. And when you go back and listen to other stuff, then it all kinds of dominoes itself together. Each little piece of this makes more sense.
Okay.
And you're right. It doesn't showcase him. Let me rephrase that. It does showcase his abilities, but not the depth of his abilities.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a true representation of his style, I would say.
No.
Mexican Green is a, I don't want to say lower, but it's a different style for him.
Yep.
Because the other albums, like I said, he's wailing away on notes and tempo and everything else. And then on Mexican Green, it's laid back. It's good.
It's laid back. One of the things that I laughed about is I was trying to figure it out with Lily and I listening to it this week. I was like, man, I know where this song, I've heard it before. And it is song number 6 on the album.
Mm-hmm.
And I could
enjoy.
What's that?
A Delicate Joy. Dedication to Joy. Dedication to Joy.
Dedication to Joy.
Yeah.
The opening is amazing, but and when it said it this week, I actually found it right before that. Benny Hill.
Okay.
Benny Hill theme.
Yes.
He breaks into a segment like that, and I'm like, wait, what's this? I don't recall how many hundreds of years ago I would have ever watched any reruns. It would have had to have been on PBS or something of Benny Hill, but and I'm sure YouTube's got it. So if you're interested in that theme, check out song number 6.
You want me to play it? Want me to try and play?
Do you have it loaded up? Do you have that?
Yep, I got it ready to go. Ready? Well, Let me skip forward just a minute.
Well, that's Mike Payne just killing it right there.
Maybe that's the wrong track.
Maybe I'll give you the wrong stuff. What I'll do, Matt, is prompt that right there. So, yeah, okay. Man, what that is Benny Hill theme. For you youngsters out there who don't know that, go check out Benny Hill and look at that. I thought it was like Red Green Show. It wasn't. It was straight up Benny Hill.
Straight up Benny Hill. Yeah, I agree.
But that led me to Mike Payne. You know, we've talked about over the year piano players. When in doubt, it's probably Herbie sitting back there. Mike Payne, his piano player on this, just beautiful to listen to. Beautiful to listen to.
I agree.
You had wanted to bring up a track earlier. I'll let you do that as I say what my week had been like, just in and out of music. Been pretty quiet around here for this last week. The girls are out on spring break over this weekend in the first part of the week. Last week, the bike shop needed some bikes built, so I was able to go in and knock some bikes out, put some more hours on there. Finished a little commercial, if you will, for New School Music. That'll hopefully be out by the time we talk about this now on their Facebook page, but it was a personal project I wanted to get done. So editing the video and sitting in front of the computer had been pretty much my week, so a whole lot of music through my ears. Some of the other things that it's funny that you have a garage door issue. Mine keeps resetting, and so it will close and then not open, or it opens and not closes. The tracks get messed up, so I have to go up to the unit and readjust so that it will open and close at the proper height and close without smashing it against the wall. So, yeah, I was dealing with some garage door stuff, and it's never good when Sarah walks in and just stares at me because I'm like, wait, that's the front door. What are you doing in through the front door? And I just immediately assume, oh, the garage door's done something wonky.
Uh-huh. And I was just replying to my wife, can I put the garage door up? Did it get fixed? Yes, ma'am. Yes, you can.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Yes, you can. That's the best answer. Happy wife, happy life.
Right.
It's been a good week. It really has. So I've got nothing to complain about, but a lot of music. I chased a lot of bunnies around the neighborhood this week, listening to almost anything and everything. With Tubby Hayes, Edwin Bryan Hayes. Yep. Tubby. Yep. I didn't realize he didn't mind the name Tubby. He was about 5'5" and he was a little plump little guy. But when they called him the Little Giant, he took offense to being short. And so his nickname was the Little Giant.
While you talk, let me start my slideshow. Is that all right?
Yeah, you got that brought up.
Yeah, I'm ready.
But as I went into the documentary and as I'd been reading this week, one of the things that was really exciting is to know that when he came over to the States and had an opportunity to play here in the States, Miles went to watch him. Album Mexican Green, do you want to talk about the slides that are up?
No, I was just going to let you talk.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, so, he came over to the States, and it was, as documentary talks about a whole lot of it, but to know that they really had, much like a cabaret card that the U.S. had for jazz musicians, you had to have permission to play. When that union fell, he had an opportunity to travel over to the U.S. and play. And they've described it in books and in reading Wikipedia, that they were throwing chord charts at him, just hoping to get him to bobble. And that's why Miles wanted to go hear him. Let's take a listen to one of the songs on the album. That way we can get a picture for how wonderful and talented he was. I didn't realize it, Matt. We've already just skipped right ahead through the week and right into Tubby. He was and should have been as big of a name as Parker, Coltrane, and Stan Getz. I think that being from the UK.
Yep, I was just going to ask you that.
Kind of really ruined it for him.
Mm-hmm.
He, even in the UK, had a very well-known name. He was a big name in the UK jazz. Mexican Green showcased his styles, but he also started to venture out into the avant-garde. And so right about that time, 67, 68, 69, you started to hear that avant-garde jazz. And he started to get into that. And it's really obvious in the album. To me, it was just super exciting to hear him play vibraphone, to hear him play the flute, to know that he was, it's not Jazz Messengers. That's not what he was. But it was the Jazz Couriers.
Couriers, yep.
Chosen by the National Jazz Federation to open for Dave Brubeck in 1958. And I happened upon that album today to listen to the Jazz Couriers. Ooh, y'all, dig into Tubby Hayes. If you didn't already listen to him one time through for this purpose, go venture off. Check into some of his other stuff. Tubbs in New York, and then Tubbs' return visit to New York. Those two albums there, he was phenomenal. And should be recognized.
Find those on Google Music?
I did find those on YouTube Music. Actually, I found Tubbs in New York. I didn't get to find Tubbs' return visit to New York on YouTube. I found somebody had posted it as a video with just a still picture over it. So I just plug it in and go.
Okay.
I did also listen to his piano player, Alone Together, was his album, Mike Payne, Alone Together. Really stinking cool. He was a piano player and a cornet player. Got several pieces where he plays his trumpet, and most of the album is just him playing piano, Alone Together.
Nice.
So the slideshow, when you get a chance, if you want to pop that back up and walk through that, you're on screen and you can do that. I think there was some highlight features in there worth noting.
Sure. Here we go.
Because I just went on. I gushed about it.
That's quite all right. No, I'm glad you did. So you said he was short in stature and a little stout. So that's an interesting perspective of a picture that I grabbed, because I was thinking the same thing. He's not tubby by any means, but he's short and stout.
Yeah.
So, and then
I'm a little teapot short and stout.
I'm a little teapot. 1935 to 1973. Unfortunately, we lost Tubby in 73. But I was reading that some of his influences swing from the 40s. And then Stan Getz. So Stan Getz was one of his influences. I was reading that on the wiki page. First solo album he did was The Little Giant Volume 1 in 55. And he's got a plethora of albums out. It's not like he's a one and done kind of guy. Mexican Green was kind of mid-career for him, I think, in 67. So, unfortunately, I don't have much of the early stuff on iTunes to choose from. So I've only got the mid, let's see what I got. Well, we did Night and Day together back when we originally did this year ago, I think. And that was a good one. That one stuck out in my mind. I love the artwork on Night and Day. It looks so modern for 1966. That was my, I like the artwork on the albums. That's just me. But you mentioned he was a multi-instrument, playing the saxophone, the flute, and the vibraphone, which he mentioned the vibraphone in one of the articles that I was reading. He said he picked it up because he wanted to see if he could do the vibraphone and make it make his voice come through like he could on the saxophone. And he never could, so he got frustrated, and he didn't really pursue the vibraphone as much. Now, we're going to be talking about some really good vibraphonists coming up.
Yeah.
And it's not that Tubby wasn't a good vibraphonist, but yeah, it's just,
when you listen to him play it, when you listen to him play it, you're thinking, how are you not?
Right. Right.
His history of music is just beyond amazing. Playing the violin, coming up with the piano. I'll let you keep reading. I want to talk about his flute playing and what he says in the documentary, which I think you'll find humorous.
Yeah. No, the note I made is for the rabbit hole is pretty much the plethora of albums. I didn't squirrel off Mexican Green too much. And then the documentary, I wish I would have had that slide up when we talked about it. It's called A Man in a Hurry. You already mentioned that. But I look forward to watching the documentary. Just the last couple of weeks, I've had a timeline kind of slide here. I didn't know where really to put him in the timeline. He's not really hard bop. He's not modern. Where kind of would you classify him? I know the genre is just jazz, but what category does he fit in? Does he fit in hard bop? Does he fit in?
I think it's interesting because I've been trying to really understand, you know, we're new to this. So when I say this, understand that I'm new to this. There is a difference between the bebop and the hard bop. And I think that one of the things I read this morning about hard bop is that it had a little bit more melody sewn into it. And so I would almost say that bebop, hard bop sound, or bebop or hard bop sound would be perfect for where Tubby is. But he's also got some West Coast smooth jazz.
Yeah.
And the vibraphone was an element of that. Because of Jazz Couriers and an album that we'll later get to, Art Blakey and Jazz Messengers is going to be part of the conversation. You're influenced by Stan Getz. You're influenced mostly by, and when I read this, Dizzy.
Yes.
Dizzy Gillespie.
As well.
And I kind of thought, how are you inspired by Dizzy as a sax player? Mm-hmm. And then when I actually read up about his inspiration, it's weird to me because it actually is less about the instrument inspiration in the progression of lyricism, is progression of phrasing on the saxophone. So Dizzy and that hard bop sound, but Dizzy at the time would have been known more for the big band.
Mm-hmm.
The Jazz Messengers would have been through the UK. And then with Getz, then he picks up on the Coltrane, which is obvious in a lot of his songs. Sonny Rollins and Hank Mobley. Later, Sim Zoot is mentioned. Which I think the bop, hard or bebop, is kind of his stick.
Okay. Maybe we ought to have a whole episode of genres like that, of just walking through the genre.
I've been thinking about that for the shorts, but it's funny, Matt, because we're the unconnoisseurs. We, what do I say to myself?
It would help us learn, though. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, if we just pulled up a genre and said, "Hey, let's talk about it. What do you think? What do you know?" and and post it. I think there's a lot that we can just read on it. I do have a book that I'll be reading in a couple of weeks, The Masters of Bop, and so I hope to have a little bit better grasp on definitions and the directions of it. But that's, you know, I finish up my Wayne Shorter book. I got a Thelonious Monk book. I got a Duke Ellington book.
I'm reading Art Pepper, so.
Yeah, I told Sarah last week, if nothing good comes out of this conversation and listening to music, I've read a lot more books than I've read in a long time. So my bookshelf and collection of jazz books is growing. Mm-hmm. And it started with one book from Richmond, Indiana. So we talk about that joke. We'll get there one day, too. What I was laughing about earlier is, or made comment, his flute playing. In the documentary, he says, "I really treated it and wanted the sound of a trumpet coming out of my flute. So that's what I worked towards." He then, I caught a part of it, which made me think I need to go back and really understand who Tubby was in his later years. After this album, he went on to record an album with a gentleman by the name of Roland Kirk.
Oh.
We'll get to him soon enough.
Yes,
it hit me that, oh man, I could spiral out of control on who Tubby Hayes was. And I made mention last night at the Jazz Ensemble to the instructor, Joe, about Tubby being able to play multiple instruments, and he says you'll never know how many he could play. Tenor sax, altone sax, and soprano, then the flute, then the vibraphones. He was an arranger, composer, and a great pianist.
Mm-hmm.
So how many more instruments along the way do we not know about? And so I almost asked Joe, were you inspired by him or just kind of know him? Joe's been playing a long time, and I have a lot of respect for the knowledge base that I throw something like Tubby out, and he's like, oh, yeah, you know, so-and-so and such, or Roland Kirk. Yeah, when he was in, I got a chance to play with him at such and such. And I'm like, man, you really are old. I hope you don't watch this, Joe, but you're old. I thought I was old, but we lost Tubby way too early. We really did. And I think that's what this album reminded me of. It led me to another album. I was listening to right before I left the shop today. Clifford Brown, blues album. And I thought, man, you know, we lose some of these greats way too early.
Way too early.
I stole that conversation about Tubby. What was your take? What was your...
You know, if Mexican Green was the only album that you listened to, you can feel good. Seriously. Because it's a great album. I texted you. What day was it? Was it yesterday or was it Saturday?
Saturday.
Just saying, man, it's in my ears again, and I think we did him wrong. you know, because here, and I think I've talked about this before too. If it's not on my phone, if it's not easy accessible to me, and I'm in the car or I'm driving to work and I can't pull it up to listen to, then I can't go back to it, or I don't remember. Sometimes when I'm sitting in front of the computer, I'm sitting on my brain, so. I forget what I want to do as soon as I sit down. And, you know, for Tubby, he probably got an unfair shake from me just because he's not right there. Mexican Green's not right there on my phone to go back to occasionally. But you take that year break or 9 month or 10 month break, and man, you come back to that after all the music that I've listened to. And he really stands up to the test of time. And I was thinking about his rating being number 92 in the magazine. I think I'm glad that he's in. Oh, that's the other thing. He's not on the 99 or 06 list. He didn't make it. The 2023 list is the first list that he's made. You know, that probably says something about their taste, about, you know, adding him to the list this year. Maybe they just found him. I doubt they just found out about him, but anyways, it was just interesting to me because, you know, coming back and listening to it again, and it's hitting my ears again, and I get all excited. One of the notes that I made in my notes, I'm looking up because I have a screen up here, is just I'm not sure that I'd be able to pick Tubby out at random. Like if it came on a TV show, you know, and you pick it up and, oh yeah, that's Tubby Hayes, I might mistake him for somebody else.
Yep.
So,
and I think that played a part in our, mm-hmm. our conversation. Cause I think that was the week I have the note written down next to Tubby. And I just want to read it. Matt's goal with this, to be able to recognize them in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been the same week we were talking about Tubby. And yep. I think it's interesting that it is right next to my notes.
Yeah.
Would you know that it was Tubby and not Sonny Rollins or Charlie Parker or Coltrane?
Right. Now, what, you know, having Mexican Green in your ear again, the tunes are recognizable.
Yeah.
They're pleasant to listen to. It's not a matter that I didn't want to listen to it.
We're improvising on this right now. I just had a technical failure on OBS. I didn't know what to do. Fortunately, the last 27 minutes were saved. But I just asked the question, would you recognize him? Would you be able to recognize him? So I want you to address that.
Well, you know, that's interesting because I think if the album Mexican Green came on, if any of the songs came on, I would recognize the album just because I've listened to it now, you know, 5, 6, 7 times beginning last year and a couple of times again this week. The tunes are recognizable, and yes, I think I would be able to recognize him now. Now, it's taken me a year to get there to recognize him. Again, I thought the mix is really good. The band behind him sounds good. And the recognizability. Now, if Tubby came on a different album, I may not know that it's Tubby, but Mexican Green, yes, I would recognize probably any song from Mexican Green.
As a UK artist in the 50s, 60s, his time live, being able to perform, passing away way too early, like that shooting star. He is a lightning fast tenor sax player, done a lot of other things. The question, did this album shake your world? First time did it?
First time? No.
The second time this week?
Second time this week? Yes.
What do you, yeah. So on correspondence with, we don't change our ratings from the first time we went through. What was your rating? What did you rate this album as back in, it was actually May 7th.
May 7th. I rated it at 7. And again, our rating system is our own opinion. If this is your first video watching The Unconnoisseur, welcome to The Unconnoisseur. And our ratings are just an opinion of how we like the album. It's not a professional stance on the artist or his playing style. It's just how we like it, how we feel about the album. So I rate it personal taste. That's right.
And I gave it a 6.5 the week that we went through it. It didn't stand out to me as recognizable. I wouldn't pick it up in a grocery store if I was listening to it. Later, I would have changed my rating. But at the time, listening to it, personal preference, it was not my big. Here we are a little under a year later, and I would say I've listened to it a bunch. I'd recognize it in the future. I still may not recognize his works. It may not stand out because it is a lot of the sound of Coltrane or Getz, other names. I don't want to bog people down, but this is personal opinion.
Let me ask you this. Would you recommend Mexican Green to a brand new jazz listener, first time jazz listener?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I think I probably would.
It's got a good sample. It's like a little poo-poo platter, a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. From smooth to the chill of piano to the avant-garde and even the Benny Hill. So
yes, for sure.
And I probably right now drop that little audio clip in. The first clip is going to be the Benny Hill theme song. The second will be Tubby Hayes playing on Mexican Green. And his work should have been more historical. We should know that name. And I think it's crying shame a year later to go back and really understand who Tubby Hayes was and to think about, wow, what we didn't know.
And the fact that we both missed the documentary a year ago, it made me laugh that we both stumbled across it last night. And had I had another 45 minutes of being awake, I probably would have watched it last night. But man, isn't that just, it's just ironic how we've circled back around to Tubby and just kind of wanted to change our scores up front. But
so I'm going to ask this, and then I know you got a reveal.
I do. I'm excited.
What would you put on a rating today? Now that you are more educated into jazz music, now that you've heard some others, and the fact is, for y'all listening to this, as we talk about it, we throw a lot of names out. The Stan Getz, the Coltrane, these are names that you won't know about yet if you're new to jazz. You've probably heard Coltrane. Dizzy but you Gillespie. Wouldn't know Mike Pine or Tony Levin, who were on this album. So bear with us as we, it's not inside jokes by any means, but this is a journey, and it's been a super fun journey. What would you rate it at today?
Today, 8.5.
Yeah, I would say 8.5 would be a pretty solid number for me.
Yeah,
it did shake my world.
It did.
This time. Both times, no, it didn't. But this time, yeah, boy. So do tell. What's okay, the reveal?
So speaking of improvised, you know, you and I are on, we're farther ahead. Week number 52, the Coleman Hawkins, a retrospective 1929 to 1963. That's number 52 in the magazine. Of course, if you've got your own copy and you're following along with
spoilers that, alert.
Yeah, spoiler alert. Okay. But we couldn't find it on YouTube Music, couldn't find it on iTunes. So I found it online, and I promised you that I would leave the package closed and that we would do the reveal on the show. So here we go. I'm opening the package. I'm opening the package. Ready?
I am. Oh, I see the name, baby.
There we go.
Oh, yeah, boy.
Excuse me. So what we had to do, we had to improvise our journey just a little bit, because this was 3 weeks ago. Okay. Yep. This was 3 weeks ago that we were supposed to cover 52. We went on to 51, did Clifford Brown and Max Roach. Oh, I
come
won't
on, stop giving
anymore.
Names away.
I won't spoil it anymore. This week has been fun for us, but now we're gonna go back and we're gonna do this album, this double CD, actually.
Yeah. When you look at it, Coleman Hawkins, 1929 to 1963. Mm-hmm. I can't. We've skipped it twice, and right. I'm kind of bummed. So tomorrow when we begin to listen to this, it's like that tiny little bit of morsel. I'm looking forward to that little bite of it, because this is going to be phenomenal.
It's going to be epic. Yeah.
Yeah. And as many people have talked about Coleman along our journey, you hear the name, right. You know the name. So,
right. So spoiler alert. And we're not going to do that too often. Again, like Drew said, we drop names because we're a little farther along, but number 52 in the magazine, Coleman Hawkins. So,
yeah, boy.
All right. So we rated Tubby, did my reveal. Now let's move on and talk about.
Boy.
Yeah, boy.
Oh, boy. So yeah. If you all are following along in your magazines, you've seen it underneath Tubby Hayes. Do you want me to? You want to?
Yes, please go.
Man, yeah. I'm going to tell you. So I'm reading Wayne Shorter's book.
Yep.
And Footprints has been a phenomenal book about Wayne Shorter. But this week is not Wayne Shorter. This week is Jaco Pastorius.
Mm-hmm.
This album is Jaco Pastorius. It was on Epic, and it came out in 1975. The list of names on here is extremely long, but they do have a soprano sax, Wayne Shorter, on there. Mm-hmm. Just dropping that in. Jaco, what we don't know today. So for all y'all listening to The Unconnoisseur, as if we were turning the page for the first time, Matt and I, a year ago, we would have said Jaco. What do you know of Jaco, Matt?
I know that he's a bass player. When I was in the military band, and especially practicing the jazz band, the bass player that we had was phenomenal. And, you know, I would always converse with him and ask him about who he liked to listen to, and he would just say Jaco. And me being a trumpet player, Jaco, yeah. Who? Jaco, you know. Jaco Blocco, an influence of his. So I probably had listened to Jaco, not knowing that it was Jaco, or have heard it in the past. But I think we're in for a treat. I think we're in for a treat. And being number 91 in the magazine means we get to listen to it even more.
Right? Well, it's kind of interesting. You say that all the time. Well, it was number 90. We're thinking it's the bottom of the list, and it shouldn't be that exciting to be at the bottom of the list, but that just means I've got 91 more weeks to enjoy Jaco.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it is a big deal. Maybe they wrote the magazine backwards. Who knows?
Who knows? Make sure you have the album art up while we talk about it.
Yeah.
But I'm going to just read through a couple of other names that play on the album. And again, it was from 1975. It's self-titled Jaco Pastorius, Herbie Hancock, Wayne Shorter, Randy Brecker, David Sanborn, Michael Brecker. Okay. That right there just pretty much tells you it's going to be good. I'm reading through the list.
Yeah. So those names definitely stick out to you.
Yes.
And as of our recording, it was a few weeks ago, there was a Michael Brecker tune that somebody AI'd Tay-Tay doing. I thought that was pretty hysterical, and I can't find it right now. I'm sure it's still out there somewhere, but she's probably long since taken it down. That would have been my introduction, and I apologize for all you sax listeners, sax players and jazz musicians. Up to this point in time, I would have heard of Wayne Shorter and Herbie Hancock. Mm-hmm. Randy and Michael, the brothers, no, I wouldn't have. And so those names didn't stand out to me, but Wayne did, and Herbie did. David Sanborn wouldn't have stood out to me. So that's what I know. You got excited about Jaco. I don't know what I'm in for. It's a black and white cover. For all of y'all following along in the Jazzwise magazine, the top 100 albums that shook the world, it's on page 10.
And we are working backwards.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So I don't know anything as of our first going through this. So I can tell you it'll be a cool week, I'm sure. If he's a bass player, it'll be fun.
Yeah, for sure.
But I'm sure we'll end up talking a little bit about Pat Metheny too.
Just saying.
His name may come up next week a little bit. All right. So you can email us at theunconnoisseur@gmail.com. It's a tough one to spell. I get it. The website is theunconnoisseur.com. I'm on TikTok at The Unconnoisseur. Drew.
And one day I'll have some YouTube shorts up there.
Working on the shorts and the Insta at The Unconnoisseur. Leave us a like and a comment on the video if you like what we're talking about this week. Let us know if we rated Tubby Hayes okay, or if you've got a different rating. We'd love to hear your feedback. You know, that's the one thing I can't wait for it to start coming in, is the feedback and the likes and everything else, so we can start reading feedback on the show and seeing how we're doing in our own journey. If you're brand new to jazz and you don't know where to start, man, follow us along, because we are on a journey together, he and I, and we are loving every minute of it. So, all right. Yep. Have a great week, guys.
Hey, see y'all. Enjoy the week of music.
Yep.
Again, number 91, Jaco Pastorius.